Welcome to Configuring an Application in OutSystems. In this session, we're going to talk about configuring application settings. And some of the settings we'll talk about are site properties, settings for timers, web references, and database connections. So let's look at these in some more detail. Applications are deployed from one environment to another, and the application source code is compiled and generated and moved to the destination environment. However, those applications often have settings that are not part of the source code, and those settings are therefore application and environment specific. Because they're not deployed, we need to be able to move them or adjust them in the new environment. So it may be necessary to be able to copy or change those and get them into the destination environment. So after deployment to a new environment, OutSystems allows us to configure the values of module parameters, and those are called site properties. We can tweak the timer configuration parameters. We can change the URL of consumed REST or SOAP web services and connections to different external databases and SAP systems. So, if we need to configure these application settings, these configurations can be created and edited per environment, and we would get to those inside of Service Center. Changing the configuration of an application doesn't need any type of republishing, nor does it imply any downtime to the end users. So let's look at the first one. For site properties, a site property is a persistent value. It's defined inside of the scope of the module, and it's used for parameterization purposes. Site properties can be changed inside of the logic or code, or can be changed directly from Service Center. But changing this at runtime has performance impact. It will invalidate the cache where this is being stored, and it can have a high impact on the load of the overall server. Now, a site property has a default value that's used for initialization purposes, and then it can have an effective value, which is the value that might be overridden. So the default value may be what is starting with, and then we'll go ahead and change that as needed. Either way, these values are not propagated during deployment. So here we can see a module, and if we go out to the far right, we can see the Site Properties tab, and we might have a maximum rating. So here we have an integer setting that has a maximum rating of 5, so we'd only be able to have a 5-star rating. If we look at that site property in detail, we can see that its default value is 5, and the effective value in use is 5, so it hasn't been overridden or changed. If we wanted to, inside of Service Center, we could change this value here to go ahead and make it a 10-star system. So it would be something that is fairly easy to change. Now, timers are schedulable asynchronous jobs, and they're defined inside of an application's module. Timers are going to execute different type of logic, and they're typically used for long-running tasks or heavy data-driven batch jobs that are done to avoid being run at peak hours. So each front-end server, by default, is allowed to run 3 timers in parallel at any given time. So we can have different apps running a timer, and these timers will be scheduled. So there will be a scheduler service that is going to look at the particular times and then activate the different timers that need to run next. And there are 3 different timer threads, so the scheduler service will be looking to constantly keep all of those threads working if there's something in the schedule to run. Now, we can configure timers per environment. So effectively, what we're doing is we're scheduling things, and we're doing it according to some period. They can be run daily, weekly, on a specific day of the week, or a specific day of the month, or we could just have them run when they're published. These timers also have priority values, so that if 2 things are scheduled at the same time, one of them could have a higher priority in the queue. And there's a timeout value that means if the timer is executing for too long, we can have a time at which it needs to stop running. So here we can see a timer, and the timer is currently set to be run in a daily type of fashion. It has a priority of 3. Its default timeout is 20 minutes. So this gives us a little bit more information whenever we need to check on a particular type of timer, and we can change these settings as needed. We also have web services, and when they're invoked inside of a module, we call how they're going to be called a web reference. So that web reference endpoint may need to be different in the development environment than it is in the quality environment or the production environment. So after deploying to a new environment, the effective URL may require revision by the operations team. So we may be setting that web reference to some default, and then they'll need to set it depending on the environment that they're in. So if we change from development to quality, we may need to change that web references endpoint. So to configure the web reference endpoint, we go to Service Center, and inside of Service Center, we'll be able to find these, and we'll be able to see the default URL and the effective URL. So the effective URL is whatever we want to enter, and then once we apply it, it will override the default. We can also change the logging level here for what is happening and how well this particular REST API is being called. And then the choices inside of our logging levels are going to be default, troubleshooting, or full logging. And last but not least, we have database connections. OutSystems allows us to easily integrate with external databases like Oracle, SQL Server, MySQL, DB2, etc. To connect to these databases, we need a database connection, and that'll need to be configured in each environment. So very similar to the web references, as we move to different environments, we may have different connections that need to be connected to. So in our development environment, we may be connecting to an external development database. And in our quality environment, we may want to connect to the external quality database. So these connections will need to change depending on the environment that we're in. So to configure these database connections, what we'll do is we'll go ahead and go to Service Center again and be able to make changes there. But there's actually two levels of changing for database connections. When we set up being able to connect to the external database, this is done via an extension module that we would have created with Integration Studio. And inside of Integration Studio, we'll create a logical database name, and that logical database name needs to be mapped to a real-life database connection in the environment where it's going to be deployed. So if we look here, we see that we have a database connection for the Northwind database. And that Northwind database connection, when we look at the extension that's been created, we may have a customer extension to get customer information out of this external database. The developers have gone ahead and called that the Northwind DB logical database. And we've created a database connection called Northwind DB. So in this case, the database connection has to be set, and we have to have the correct logical name given by the developer. In this case, it's relatively easy because the teams chose the same names. That also could potentially be a little confusing, but we do see that there are two pieces that need to connect here. As we move from one environment to the next, this database connection may change, or we could set it up with a similar name as well. So that's it for configuring our applications with the different types of things that might need to be adjusted as we move and deploy applications in between environments. That's it. So thanks for watching, and have a great day.